Good morning. Thank you for being here for this event. My name is Andrew Metrick. I'm a research associate with the International Security Program here at CSIS. And before I start today's event, I just wanted to run through a brief safety announcement. Overall, we feel really safe in the building, but as someone who runs many events, we sort of have a responsibility to sort of let you know what we will do in a case of emergency, what the options are for you. So the emergency exits from this room are either through that door or out the back. I will be the responsible safety officer, so in the case of emergency, look for me and I will be the one that's directing you where you need to go. So that out of the way, I'd like to introduce Mr. Ken Rapuano, who's the Senior Vice President at the ANSER Corporation. He's also the Director of HSSAI, which is DHS's FFRDC. He is quite new to his job, so this is his first public event. And prior to joining the ANSER Corporation, he was at MITRE, where he was the Director of Advanced Systems and Policy. He was working on a broad swath of homeland security issues, and he has a recent focus on some non-traditional threats to aviation. So with that, I'll turn it over to Ken.
Thanks a lot, Andrew. It really is a privilege to be here. I am Ken Rapuano. I'm a fresh face at the ANSER Corporation, but pretty long in the tooth in the Homeland Security and Counterterrorism mission area. I did just start at ANSER 2 weeks ago. I am very pleased that this is my first public event. I think that this is a critically important issue. I think that the events over the last year and really over the last several weeks have heightened concerns about asymmetric threats and capabilities, and I think unmanned systems are a significant and growing concern in that regard, in addition to the obvious and many legitimate and beneficial applications. For those of you not familiar with ANSER, just a little bit of background. It's a public service research institute, an independent, not-for-profit corporation founded in 1958. It was in November 99 that the ANSER CEO at the time, Dr. Ruth David, created the ANSER Institute for Homeland Security that was formally established in April of 2001. So pretty forward-thinking in retrospect when you look at the chain of events following that. And since then, ANSER and CSIS have really been strong collaborative partners in the Homeland Security mission area. We've done numerous projects over the years. In 2001, we partnered on the Dark Winter series of exercises with the National Security Council staff. It was really the first large area biological attack scenario, and those in that WMD field, I think all are pretty familiar with what a significant event that was in terms of enhancing an understanding of what the dynamics of that space are. In June 2001, again, we did the National Security Council event. Most recently, we've been working with CSIS on the UAS, or really the Unmanned System Challenge. Obviously, there's been a lot of focus on the aerial piece of that, but clearly other systems developed in that space. So the issue of how to best leverage technological innovation to enhance national and homeland security are of deep interest to both our organizations. And in a world where the highly advanced technologies are increasingly ubiquitously available to the general public, the benefits also come with risks. This, of course, is a challenge that's not limited to unmanned systems. We're living in a time where the scope, pace, and increasingly ubiquitous availability of advanced technologies is unprecedented. Many of these technologies are developed for legitimate beneficial purposes, but they have the potential through irresponsible or malevolent use to pose serious threats to our way of life. I don't know if you caught the little piece in the Washington Post yesterday. It's about Elon Musk and some other big tech leaders like Peter Thiel of PayPal, Amazon Web Services. They just instantiated a committee with $1 billion of resources called Open Artificial Intelligence, specifically aimed at encouraging responsible AI development. Musk has called artificial intelligence humanity's greatest existential threat. He's compared it to summoning the demon, expressing the concern that humanity will develop artificial intelligence so smart that it becomes a threat to humanity itself. Think of the self-aware killer robots that realize, after monitoring the situation, that the best course of action is to wipe out mankind. So that was really just a feature of science fiction movies a short time ago, and now we have very serious people in government and in industry who are very concerned about the potential downside implications of some of these advanced technological developments. And Musk has called artificial intelligence humanity's biggest existential threat. So it's really a signpost for us all when we look at these technologies and their implications. So while this is several steps ahead of where we are when it comes to manned technologies, the rapid pace of change requires that we think ahead. And while most of us are familiar with the nature and capabilities of unmanned systems through their military applications, particularly, again, the aerial-based systems, these developments provided the foundation for non-military innovation and development, from which over the last 5 years, there's been an explosive growth, particularly in the unmanned aerial systems. Just a couple of facts in terms of the development of the UAS unmanned platforms. The sale of consumer drone systems in 2015 is expected to exceed 4.3 million units worldwide. The FAA has estimated that just in this Christmas holiday season, there will be over 1 million UAS vehicles sold in the United States. And you'll see that's a driver for some of the FAA decisions coming out. Our report, which was published in January of this year, provides an assessment of the current and potential uses of unmanned systems in Homeland Security, of which there are many. In most areas of unmanned technology, the military has pioneered the development of the use, maritime, land, and air. The military R&D contributed to development of unmanned systems across a spectrum of recreational, commercial, and civil government applications. Our report identifies a number of areas where the federal government and state and local governments have begun to apply these systems to perform dangerous, difficult, or otherwise prohibitively costly tasks safely and more efficiently. The report also notes that the advances in unmanned systems technology present benefits as well as risks to the Homeland Security enterprise. And these dynamics will need to be better understood and managed. Now, due to the vagaries of the Homeland Security approval process for public release, our report, which was published in January, just was recently released to the public last month. So I probably don't need to tell you that a lot has happened in this landscape over the last 11 months. And the following is really a best of sampling. In January, we had the DJI quadcopter landing on the White House lawn. It was not detected at the time of its flight by the Secret Service. It was found early in the morning. Ultimately, it was determined to be a drunk drone driver who landed it. In April, the now famous gyrocopter incident, where a disgruntled postal employee took off from Gettysburg in a small lawnmower-powered type helicopter, flying through the totality of our restricted airspace in the NCR, and landing unmolested on the lawn of the Capitol. In April, a small drone containing traces of radiation lands on the roof of the Japanese Prime Minister's office. In May, as a result of the gyrocopter incident, some hearings that followed that were not quite satisfactory to many of representatives on the House and the Senate, the U.S. government initiated a whole-of-community working group chaired by the Department of Homeland Security's S&T Directorate to assess and develop approaches to address non-traditional aviation threats to the National Capital Region and consider the implications for the rest of the U.S. By virtue of that last event that got so much attention, the gyrocopter being a manned platform, that's where we get this new acronym of NTAT. But I think that for the most part, the primary concern and focus based on a number of attributes of unmanned systems is on unmanned systems. In July, two cyber researchers demonstrate how a Jeep Cherokee can be commandeered wirelessly from afar. Dashboard, steering, brakes, and transmission controlled, ultimately driving the vehicle into a ditch, which has spurred a lot of efforts within the automotive community to address those cyber vulnerabilities. And in this time frame, there have been a variety of close calls between small drones and commercial as well as general aviation aircraft on takeoff and landing. This week, really 2 days ago, the FAA announced the requirement to register and mark all small drones from 0.5 pound up to 55 pounds under penalty of civil fines of up to $27,500 and criminal fines of up to $250,000 and up to 3 years in prison. That's a big change, and that's going to be extremely difficult to implement. The FAA has got additional regulations governing the use and airspace management associated with unmanned systems that are in the works. In fact, they've been in the works for an extended period of time due to the complexity of the trade space issues associated with finalizing them. So in sum, we have yet to have what I call a really bad day associated with unmanned systems, and again, the most prevalent being the aerial systems. But some, including myself, believe that it's only a matter of time before that happens, and we need to really be prepared for the implications to how this space is going to move forward when that does occur. So the whole of government process is really the first focused effort to consider more of the threat aspects associated with unmanned vehicles, aerial vehicles, again, in this case. There have been a number of interagency efforts associated with looking at counter UAS as well as beneficial use of UAS, but the whole of community effort is really integration force for those. And I would just say a lot of very important good work has been done in that area, and it's continuing today. But I'd also say the first lesson thus far from this process is that evaluating relative risk and benefits presented by these systems and understanding those lessons is critical. It's one thing to talk only about the benefits of UAS, and there are a lot of folks who do that. It's another thing to only talk about the threats associated with these platforms, and you've got a community of people who specialize in that. But looking at how we're going to balance the two is really the challenge. So the second lesson, that is at least for me, is that the first lesson is much easier said than done. But that's the road that we're on. Getting on that side associated with the potential risks associated with these systems, really it's the ability of malevolent actors being a prime concern. And it's really that these terrorist actors, and we've witnessed most recently in Paris and San Bernardino, are looking for high consequence, high shock type of events. And these technologies provide the ability to circumvent traditional security measures. They provide a force multiplying effect in terms of simultaneous or sequential attacks. They also require fewer operatives. Fewer operatives means less signatures for intelligence and law enforcement. And ultimately, they provide increased anonymity to the users, which is a significant enabler from a terrorist or a criminal perspective. On the other hand, again, these technologies will increasingly provide significant advantages to society, but again, they're balanced by the range of threats, and we've not fully considered or prepared for these threats. They can't be uninvented. There's no putting the genie back in the bottle when it comes to these technologies. And again, they proliferated almost immediately to the private sector and recreational users. You can purchase now on Amazon systems that only nation states could produce 4 or 5 years ago. And you're seeing that increased compression of time and space associated with the development of advanced technology and its transition into the the public sector in terms of availability to a wide range of actors. So particularly in light of recent events, unmanned platforms are really not the au courant issue in town or elsewhere. It's certainly an issue that many of us are focused on, but it's not getting those headlines. The real question, though, is how long will it be before there is a Paris or San Bernardino type event in which these platforms play a significant role? And how's that going to change the landscape? And how are we going to adapt to that? How are we not going to throw the baby out with the bathwater when it comes to all of these beneficial, more efficient approaches to leveraging these technologies for good, but balancing that against making it more difficult and creating signatures of those activities of those who you seek to use them malevolently or irresponsibly, particularly in applications that present the greatest consequence. So while these are equities that are important, when we have equities that are really critical to protect against these platforms, and we can think of places in very close proximity to where we are today, there really is no price that we're not willing to pay when it comes to building capabilities to mitigate the threats. The trouble is it really doesn't scale and sustain. You can't protect every potential targets, particularly soft targets. You can't build the equivalent of Iron Dome defenses around every attractive target to an actor who seeks to do great harm with these systems. So there really is no single approach. We're not going to put that genie back in the bottle. We need to take a systems approach, understanding the trade space associated with where in what we would call the kill chain or the threat chain of activities that a bad actor or a high consequence irresponsible actor might take to circumvent regulations, to circumvent geofencing and other types of technologies that are used to mitigate the use of these vehicles in certain places. How do we look at that full continuum of those activities and identify where we're going to get best effect in terms of mitigating the threat? I think many of you are aware this is an approach that was pioneered in the counter IED campaigns, first in Afghanistan and then Iraq. We spent an inordinate amount of time and effort in the first few years and billions of dollars focused on the device itself. We found that the adversary was very easily able to circumvent them, their OODA loop, their activity in response to our countermeasure loop was much shorter than our ability to put more effective responses in. We started looking what was called left of boom. In the UAS context, we talk about left of flight. Again, what are those signature activities? How can we make it more difficult, create obstacles, again, to those activities and behaviors that present the greatest concern? So in sum, this is an extremely difficult challenge that sooner or later we are going to be confronted with in a very serious way, and we delay real sustained focus and effort to address and balance the risk and benefits at our own peril. Now on that high note, I'm going to turn it over to Sam and have him walk through more of the details of the report. Thank you very much.
Good morning. I'm Sam Brannon. Nice to see lots of familiar faces in the audience. I was part of the report team that wrote the study when I was at CSIS as a senior associate. I'm now at A.T. Kearney in our Global Business Policy Council there, but I am a non-resident senior associate here at CSIS, and for the sake of full transparency, I have zero material interest in appearing before you today to talk about the report, but I am proud of the report and proud to represent the report team that put this together. And among them, Matt Fleming, who was the study lead, Andy Mosier, who's hiding somewhere probably here. There he is. Good to see you, Andy, who was the legal sage and overall sage on the report. Brian Altmaier, Andrew Metrick, who also organized today's report. Thank you, today's conference, rather. Meredith Boyle and Rick Say. But like a rock and roll band, we've all scattered to the wind, but we're back here to play our greatest hit, this report, which is coming out about a year after we had let the ink dry on it. And I think Ken did a great job of getting you up to speed on all that's changed. I also want to thank Kath Hicks, Phil Anderson, and Rick Kohut, who did a great job supporting the team and giving us great feedback. And most of all, let me say thank you to the Senior Advisory Committee. Admiral Jim Loy is here today. Among the advisors also were John Hamry, Congressman Sylvester Reyes, Fran Townsend, and General Michael Kostelnik. And having that senior level group helped us, I think, to really focus on what was important at a secretary level as a takeaway from all of this data about UAS in the homeland space. So you've got the report in front of you. I will not belabor the summary, but I will tell you that there are a few takeaways that jumped out to us as we put this together. The first is the scope of this report is extremely broad, and it was intentionally broad, and it was really meant as a survey of the landscape to identify what was interesting and what should really be studied about this. We see snippets in the news every day. We hear snippets about White House interest or a one-off event or one dimension of unmanned systems, but we wanted to take a holistic look at what are the requirements for, constraints on, and implications of the use in unmanned systems across the Homeland Security enterprise. So that included state and local, that included first responders, that included private sector partners, that included Department of Homeland Security, that included federal law enforcement. So thinking across the totality there, what was going on, what are the use cases today, what are the potential future use cases, where is the technology going, how fast is it maturing, how cost effective is it, how usable is it? So we looked at all of those issues. We also observed that there really hadn't been examination made in particular of the use of unmanned systems technology in a Homeland Security enterprise. We've seen a lot on Department of Defense and intelligence, where frankly the capability is nothing short of revolutionary. And so we asked the question, is it equally revolutionary for the Homeland Security enterprise? How did we get at that information? It's scattered all over the place, and I hope that in the report now we've concentrated it a little bit more, so whoever looks into issues next has a starting point that's better than Wikipedia or FOIA requests or sort of one-off entries that we see out there. But we had conversations with a very interdisciplinary group, including the roboticists around Pittsburgh who are working on this issue now, including the operators who are out there experimenting with the technology, and including hobbyists and regulators from the NTSB to the FAA. We really tried to understand all the stakeholders involved. Before I get into the detailed findings, let me just acknowledge two elephants in the room. The first is CBP's Office and Air and Marines Predator Guardian UAS fleet. This is the issue that usually sucks the oxygen out of the room whenever we talk about unmanned systems in a homeland context. As you probably already know, since 2005, CBP has operated the Predator B UAS. They now operate 9 UAS, including a maritime variant called the Guardian. These operate out of 3 primary sites nationwide. They're focused on the border security mission, though they have been used in other applications. And let me tell you that the entire report could have been on this simple question of what use is being made of these systems? Are they the right systems? Should there be other systems? Should DHS operate a capability like this? But that's not the theme of the report. We kept it broad. But I will tell you that in looking at this specific issue, we recognize very quickly that even the metrics that are frequently used to discuss the efficiency and effectiveness of these systems, such as cost per flight hour, really don't apply in the same way to unmanned as they do to manned systems. So that's at the core of the problem in figuring out whether this is a cost-effective way to do border security. The second that's related is that we would have had to get into the conops of border security, and that's an entirely different issue set that consumes many people and that many people make a good living off of in this town. So we'll leave it to them to comment on it. We will only acknowledge that this is a military-grade capability. It's almost identical to what the Air Force operates. It is an exquisite capability. It's a capability that few militaries in the world have, let alone few Border Patrol agencies. So. And we'll say also that the unmanned systems do offer some intrinsically unique capabilities that manned platforms don't, but at the same time, the platform sensors that are on them can be transferred to other platforms. So that's something to bear in mind. The second elephant in the room is FAA rulemaking, and Ken teed that up nicely in terms of talking about what developments have happened. It's only fair to say that the rulemaking process has gone very slowly, and it's only fair to say that it's gone very slowly for a number of very good reasons, including zero tolerance for a decrease in aviation safety as a result of introducing UAS. And when you look at UAS, and particularly small UAS, those under 55 pounds, there are a number of simply technical safety challenges that have to be overcome, specifically sense and avoid technology. And until those are overcome, there's a very good reason why UAS might be line of sight only operation, and why the use of these systems in other countries in a more permissive environment are not necessarily applicable in the U.S., where we have more congested airspace in some cases and more sensitivity to failure in others. At the same time, there are three outcomes that result from that slow FAA rulemaking. The first is that the U.S. is less competitive commercially than other countries, Canada, France, Switzerland, Australia, I can name many others, for R&D and experimentation with UAS, as well as for commercial use. The U.S., from a competitiveness standpoint, is falling behind other countries because of the regulatory decisions that we're making. That's point of fact. The second is that slow regulation has resulted, at least to date, in something of a Wild West situation. This is a situation where a drone lands on the White House lawn and you don't know where it came from. You don't know who flew it. You don't know who got it there. And it also amounts to a lot of commercial use that's going on that's well outside of the FAA case, because people either don't know about FAA rulemaking because they don't check the FAA rule site when they buy a drone because they don't think to do it, or because they don't care. The enforcement is extremely weak, the legal precedent is very murky, and they're willing to take the chance. If you're a realtor and you think you can sell a home faster by putting a drone up and taking great aerial photos, you're going to do it. What's the risk in doing it? When was the last time you saw a realtor arrested for flying a drone? But when you multiply that across the United States, across commercial sectors, it becomes very confusing and congested. And third, the adoption of UAS in the Homeland Security enterprise has been slowed by FAA rulemaking. We heard from a variety of potential users that they are simply waiting for rules and reliable sense and avoid technology. So those are the consequences that come from that. Beyond the Predator fleet, the real story of unmanned systems in the Homeland Security enterprise is about small UAS, those systems that are 55 pounds and below. This is where we've seen a stream of, frankly, very balkanized activity. This is where there's a lot of experimentation that's gone start-stop, ongoing, that there's a lot of user interests, perhaps not yet realized or satisfied, and that we're transitioning from DoD legacy systems to commercial off-the-shelf systems, which creates a range of other difficulties. At the time that we wrote this report, only the FBI had small UAS in regular operational use. Others had experimented with it, but importantly, only the FBI, and that was line of sight only, and that was in very niche applications. Beyond that, they would not give us details, and it probably would not be fit for the public report, but notable in light of all of the concerns that we hear about the operation of UAS, that's the only ongoing. DHS S&T had launched a very helpful program in 2012 that they called a Consumer Reports for Small UAS, where they brought in commercial off-the-shelf vendors and tried to see what the actual capabilities were of the systems that were out there and how useful they would be in first responder situations, and try to rank this. And I understand that program has been resuscitated with a maritime bent. That's a very positive development from the report team's point of view. And then state and local responders across the country are using small UAS, we found, somewhat to our surprise, in very small numbers and in very restrictive ways. They are not putting drones over people's houses and conducting persistent surveillance. That's not happening, as far as anyone we could tell would acknowledge when we talk to people around the country. They are using them increasingly in some tactical response situations, and they are using them in accident photographing, documenting type applications, but quite limited. And in fact, the interest was not as great as we might have thought it would be. There's experimentation going on. We observed the state of Virginia conducting a search and rescue operation using small UAS to see what they were capable of. What first responders are encountering increasingly is commercial and personal users who are now flying UAS over accident scenes, which is complicating very dramatically their own response efforts. And finally, hobbyists, which Ken referred to, this giant booming market. So if little Susie gets the drone she asked Santa for this Christmas, that's going to continue the congestion of the space. Ground vehicles, very limited use, once again. What we've seen mostly is the use of EOD robots, very basic ground UAVs. We expect growth in that area, but frankly, there's not a lot going on either on the DoD side, and that's where a lot of the technology would transition from. Self-driving cars is probably the area where we would see the most activity in coming years. On the maritime side, Admiral Loy and I were discussing this beforehand. There's a lot going on in the U.S. Navy now, which may eventually have application in homeland, but as of now, very, very limited interest in use of unmanned systems in the maritime domain. So let me, in the interest of getting to the great panel that we have, cut to the chase now, to tell you that I think we will cover, Jay will help us talk about the considerations around privacy, civil liberties, and how UAS tie in more generally to the kind of data that government are able to collect through a variety of sensors, and we would identify UAS as unique in their mobility more than anything else. The sensors that you put on a UAS, you can put on anything else, you could put on a telephone pole, but the ability to move them around, the ability to go up and over things unobstructed where you might have ground barriers in place is a major consideration. And let me say that in terms of the requirements side of this, what are the future requirements? There are a number of unique attributes about unmanned systems that again, Ken referred to, the dull, dirty, dangerous jobs. There are also, in our mind, one of the more compelling reasons to adopt unmanned systems is cost. It is a democratization of a capability that was very expensive. You had to mount it on rotary or fixed wing. Aviation is not cheap, cost per flight hour is not cheap, yet if you get a small UAS, you can mount a HD, fairly capable camera on it, and for under $2,000, you can have a capability that would have cost you, you know, $2,000 for a half hour years ago. And so this is in the hands of multiple users potentially, but in the kind of sensors you can put on these platforms, you could potentially realize a number of currently unmet Homeland Security requirements. You could increase safety of operations in various cases, and you could increase your potential coverage of surveillance on the border, for instance, without increasing manpower, because these systems don't have the sort of manpower tail associated with the larger UAS. So let me conclude by saying that this is indeed a space that's going to be more and more complicated, not least because it's driven by commercial interest. From the million drones that'll be sold this Christmas to the expectation that by 2020 this will be a $1.2 billion industry, to the valuation of DJI technology, which has just received an inject of $75 million in private equity money, and is now valued at $8 billion. This is the maker that created the drone that landed on the White House lawn, is now increasingly into agriculture. This is a global industry, so it's not U.S. makers that are necessarily leading the way. The French drone maker Parrot just reported that its consumer drone market saw a revenue increase of 483% between this year and last, while its commercial drone revenues increased 164%. So this is going to get the attention of the business community. It's going to accelerate. It doesn't take a particularly vivid imagination to conceive of bad ways actors might use this. It doesn't take a very great business plan to figure out how you might make money with one of these systems. Certainly Amazon doesn't throw money around into technologies that don't become something. And their keen interest on this is sector leading and has many others interested in what's the commercial application of last mile delivery for unmanned systems. We're seeing a huge growth in this sort of home delivery economy. This is simply going to be more and more a part of our daily lives. And so it's a space that needs to be watched very, very carefully. And that was really the key takeaway from our report. Which is, it's never great to have a study that calls for another study, unless you're in the study business, of course. But we thought that this was a Deputy Secretary of Homeland Security issue. And that was something that the senior advisory group agreed with us on. That they challenged us. They said, you weren't being bold enough with where we'd recommended it go. And I know over the last year, this has become a Deputy Secretary issue, both through unity of effort and through the counter UAS pop-up. But really getting a hold of this is going to require a group within DHS to come and bring the threats, the opportunities, the current use cases, the potential future use cases, and an understanding of the technology, bring that all together and make senior leadership conversant in it. So we stand by the recommendation that this is among the many priorities DHS has. Unmanned systems have to be up there. They have to be up there with technologies like cyber. And they are interlinked to cyber in many ways. And I'll cut myself off on the other recommendations and thank you so much and look forward to the remarks of the panel.
Well, thank you, Ken, and thank you, Sam, and absolutely delighted to have both of you here, and in equal measure, of course, I will say with Sam as a former colleague, we're so glad that A.T. Kearney allowed you to come back and brief out this great work that you helped lead and put together, along with all the others that you mentioned in your acknowledgments. So great to have you back, and thank you for those remarks, both of you, very, very enlightening. I'm Andrew Hunter. I'm director of the Defense Industrial Initiatives Group here at CSIS, and as my job title implies, I spend more time usually talking about defense aspects of technology than homeland security aspects, but it's a pleasure to join the panel today, and I noted in reading the report one of the main findings is that it is very dangerous and probably misleading and incorrect to try to extrapolate from defense applications of unmanned systems to homeland security applications. There are very important differences that the report highlights. And so the good news is I have the easiest job on the panel today. All I have to do is moderate and ask questions, and I can let all the smart folks that have been recruited to talk to you do the hard work. And so why don't we get to that? I have to my left Admiral James Loy, really needs no introduction, former Commandant of the Coast Guard, former head of TSA, former Deputy Secretary of Homeland Security. To his left, Tim Bennett, who is in the Directorate of Science and Technology at the Department of Homeland Security, and a fairly recent arrival there, although a very deep background in the technology of intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance. With applications, obviously, to discussion today and to unmanned systems. To his left, Jay Stanley, who's a senior policy analyst at ACLU and also a technology guru and his history, and he focuses very much on the privacy aspects of technology and where that policy is heading. So we have someone who's a former operator. We have an S&T guy and we have a policy guy, so we've got the full set of issues covered for you today. And let me just briefly turn, Admiral, to you if you have some just opening thoughts that you want to give us on this topic.
Okay, Andrew, thanks. And it's great to see a couple of familiar faces in the audience from way back in plank-owning days standing up the department. as well as lots of new faces, which I hope is a signal that there's a lot of new blood in the system that are trying to tackle these extraordinarily difficult problems. I had a handful of notes here that I had thought my way through last evening to share with you, but I think the word that I'd like to leave with you is complexity. To think that where we find ourselves with regard to the UAS systems, and when I say those, I mean all three domains, because that's one of the elements of the complexity that we're associated with here in our conversations. But when you think of the new technology on the market, you can think back to any number of new technologies that have found their way into our world of work, and find that we are sort of trying to take a snapshot of where we are in the middle of the journey that is going to take us to where we think we want to go. And that's one of the most difficult things that we find going on, whether you're in the R&D business in a major corporation in this country, or whether you are in the S&T business and the policy shop associated with DHS, or the other cabinet-level agencies that have a stake in the game here, so to speak, as we talk about unmanned systems. So you end up with this array of sort of dimensions of the problem that I think are worth at least taking an inventory of for a moment. First of all, you have the notion of capability that finds its way onto the table, which gets everybody excited, whether it's in the military applications or the domestic applications or recreational applications. And the capability thing, in with regard to this challenge that we're talking about today, has, like many other technological advances in our history and in the world's history, pressed themselves into our vision, so to speak, well in advance of the governance conversation that has to go on at the same time. So we find ourselves here again in the midst of a FAA effort to come up with a rulemaking package that was begun and supposedly to be reported in 2012, and here it is 2015, and there's lots of reasons, as I think both Ken and others have said already, as to why we haven't gotten the full rulemaking a package on the table already by the FAA, but that's one of the complexity elements that I think we have to grapple with. We're excited about the capability, but even in our excitement, we then recognize the twofold street with regard to really good applications of this new technology and really bad applications of this new technology, depending on who it is that's actually trying to use it. And at the same time we're trying to understand that, we are frustrated with the developmental timeline attendant to the governance issues, the rulemaking in this instance, the most specific piece, but the governance issues that are grappling with it. The second element of this complexity thing is the fact that it is being pushed in our face whether we like it or not. I look back just on the last 2 days' worth of articles in the press. I'm on Lockheed's board, for anybody that is in Lockheed's interest out there. And they have a news service that they feed the board members on a daily basis. Well, I looked through the one that I got this morning, and there's 5 articles in a news service that talks about 25 articles. 5 of them have to do with what are we doing about UAS? And they range from a governance conversation going on in India, again, a reinforcement of the global nature of what we're talking about, to a variety of different things associated with scope, application, intensity here in the United States. So element number one, the notion of capability versus governance. Element number two, it's right in front of us and being pushed right in front of us, either by events or by reviews that are going on that are very appropriate to take on. The third element is this notion of the domains in which we're trying to deal with potential applications and potential solutions. We are dealing with in the air, on the land, and on the sea and under the sea. The last couple of years have shown rather dramatic interest and improved interest on the part of the under the sea part from the U.S. Navy. The Coast Guard is involved in that thought pattern primarily from the standpoint of always trying to let the big guy do all the investment of R&D. Well, we'll come up in the tail end of things and hope that our stakes are owned inside that total study process and such that both of those maritime services end up with the benefits of what has gone on over time. So under the sea, on land, as Ken said, we started this business out with regard to what are we going to do about EOD challenges in Afghanistan and Iraq, and we find ourselves already looking at Tesla advertisements about what you and I are going to be trying to avoid on the highways over the course of the next. And when we look over there, and there doesn't seem to be anybody behind the wheel, mainly because there's nobody behind the wheel. So the applications in the air, on the land, on the sea is yet another dimension of the complexity of this challenge that we're trying to think our way through. Some plain old facts. Somebody mentioned the million systems that are likely to be in Susie's stocking under the tree this year, just in our country, let alone the worldwide implications of that. Business Week last week suggested that it's an $8+ billion immediate aftermath of FAA coming up with their rulemaking in terms of where business and the business community will be going to try to take advantage and learn from what the new governance structure is offered to be and get on with taking advantage of the money-making opportunity that it represents for business out there in the private sector world. All good things. So this this notion of how many of them in our face, capability versus governance, is a statement about the reality on the reality of it all. That is a challenge to policymakers in government, is a challenge to rulemakers in government, like the FAA is challenged to do. But it's also an enormous opportunity for good, if in fact we can find our way to deal, whether it's counter UAS, the new array of work that we're that many people are working on in government, or whether it's the classic traditional threat identification, how do you mitigate that threat and deal with it in terms of program applications that many, many agencies in government are going to be trying to cope with over the course of the next weeks and months. So in terms of being limited, I understand, Andrew, to 5 or 6 minutes, it's almost impossible to not talk about 5 or 6 hours worth of commentary in this kind of a subject area. But let me just leave you with those thoughts to amplify the one word that I'd ask you to take away. This is an extraordinarily complex thing that we're trying to grapple with today.
Thank you, Admiral. And having started my career working in the House of Representatives, where 1 minute was the standard, 5 minutes used to seem like an eternity, but mm-hmm. after just 1 year at a think tank, I'm with you. I find it to be a very short period of time. But thank you for keeping your remarks limited. Tim.
Okay. Yeah, what I want to do is I have to get help with the discussion. I want to go over what DHS, Science and Technology is doing in terms of UASs. I want to look at what this report is, which is the past. I want to talk about what we're doing now, being 2015, 2016, and then talk about where we're going to be going in the future with this. If you've read the report already, you've noticed that about 2004 is when the CBP actually started using UASs and the whole DHS started using them, when they were using Hermes, first on the border of Arizona, then going into using the Hunter, and then finally acquiring their own systems and using the MQ-9, which is your Predator B. They grew that up until 2009, where they had enough sufficient, so they left not only Arizona, but they started also flying in North Dakota. Then after that, roughly the same time, they were able to meet with the Coast Guards, come up with a joint operation where they got the Guardians and started flying maritime operations out of Corpus Christi. In addition to that, the Coast Guard during that initial time period, which is 2004-2014, they started looking at different systems with the Navy. They were looking at a Fire Scout, which is a helicopter system, roughly a three-man helicopter, to use for shipboard operations. They also started looking at some of the larger 55 pounds and up UASs that were essentially rail launched and were able to be captured by a tether and then landed on a ship. So that was pretty much what happened in those time frames. And one thing else brought up is that we had the RAPS program, which was funded out of DHS, out of S&T, which somebody mentioned earlier was to help the first responders. The idea was to show what you could do with these things, bring in different companies, and run against scenarios that the police department, the fire department, border patrol would need to be able to do the jobs in the future. For that study, we actually did 15 different companies with 25 different aircraft and put together this consumer report that was mentioned a little bit earlier. And there was really two reports came out of there. There was a like a executive summary that was available to anybody in the public. And it really just gave an overview. And then they also did a very detailed report that's only available to first responders and government employees because it contained a lot of proprietary information, but it also gave a lot of great details to those that would look at procuring systems in the future. Does this fit my needs? How does it really react against a fire? How does it really react in case I got to go around a corner and see somebody shooting at me? By the end of the 14th, as it came up, is that they were afraid of the federal FAA not moving quick enough on terms of coming up with policies to fly in the national airspace. So pretty much everybody stood down. They were not going to go further with it. Fortunately enough, in 2015, there was a resurgence, especially for small UASs, for all the components, to start using them. They saw that there was a great need for these things. Coast Guard really took a big leap forward in 2015, starting of that period. They started adding UASs to their Arctic Shield program, which they've been running for several years. They were flying Pumas off ships to see how it would work in terms of finding men in the water, oil spills, whatever it would be. And then they're also doing, Scan Eagle on land operations to see how that would work doing the same kind of scenarios. They also put together a tether program looking at UASs and flying wings to be able to do continuous ISR operations off of ships. What's nice about that is because on the tether you run your power, you run your signal up the tether, so you can do 24/7 as long as the ship is moving. You have operations, so you can put them up 1,000 feet, 3,000 feet, according to what your operation is, and give a constant stare on what's out in the ocean. And the last thing that they really got involved with in 2015 was putting together this RAMPS program. RAMPS is an offshoot of the RAPS program. It's also funded by S&T. And what that is to look at roughly the same thing as they did for the RAMPS program, but it looked specifically maritime operations. And the first one, it's in operation now, is called RAMPS 1A. And what we're doing is they pick five aircraft to be able to work in a marine environment and test them similarly to like they did on the RAPS program and write a report up so you know for maritime operation, this will find a man in the water, this will find speedboats, this will find whatever you happen to be looking for, and then write up those reports. What the next step is for this RAMS program, which is all RAMS 1B, which will start in June of this year, is we're going to be looking at different locations around the United States. The RAMS 1A was at Webster Field down at PAX. Next time we're going to be going to Alaska, Florida, other regions around the United States to see how they do in different environments, because if you've done enough with aircraft, you find out they do operate completely different according if it's really cold, high humidity, whatever it happens to be. So that is going to be the 1B, and then we're going to go to a RAMPS 2, which is going to be working with NATO countries, Australia, and any other friendly countries to see how we can work together in terms of maritime and hopefully border patrol in terms of collaborating, putting our research dollars together and come up with better solutions for Homeland Security. Along with the RAMPS program, we have started the RAPS 2 program, which is again, very similar to the first one. The first one really geared itself to first responders. This next go around, we're going to be specifically for the Border Patrol. They have special needs, a lot different than first responders do. So we are going to be starting demonstrating that in the first demonstration is the 11th of January. It's going to be out at Fort Sill where we did the last demonstrations. The difference on this one, though, is we're going to be doing night operations, daytime operations. We have 13 companies and over 20 aircraft are going to be testing between January and July of this year to put together, again, the same kind of consumer reports. In addition to the programs, we're also investing a lot of new research. in the past, we have not really put money into it, but we do see a need for it, that we can't move forward unless we have the help solve the problems. For the large aircraft, for the MQ-9s and other platforms, we have now helped fund looking at a better mission management system, which is the Minotaur system. It's the Navy system, and it gives them better capability of controlling not only planning your mission, running your mission, and then sharing the data later on for intelligence-type work. What's nice about this also is now the Coast Guard is going the same route, so we're going to have the Navy, Coast Guard, and CBP all using the same operating system, which will allow us then to merge data together, do better synergy, and come up with better solutions to our problems. Big thing for the Air and Marine, CBP in general, is detecting motion on the ground. We're helping fund moving target indicator systems, sensors for the MQ-9 and others, so they'll be able to see if they have a dismount or if they have a man on the ground and be able to follow them and do an interdiction if required. For the smaller stuff, you know, what came up here is we have millions of aircraft going to be in the air, all these UASs. So what we're funding with Ames Research Center out in California, they have a huge program on how to do unmanned traffic management. And we're funding that significantly to be able to help put together a management system that will help the Border Patrol and others in our group be able to fly UASs in the same airspace as helicopters and others. Because if you find out, if you talk to people from CBP, the biggest threat they have right now is that they have a Border Patrol guy throwing a hand launch up in the air, and they have a helicopter coming in, they don't know where they are. So we need to come up with how to control that issue. And the last one is that the bad guys on the borders have lots of money, and what they're putting money into is into spoofing and jamming of GPSs. So we're doing funding to look at small UASs that we can counter this, not essentially go after them, but to say, if you're spoofing me and tell me I'm in the wrong location, I know you're telling me the wrong location, find the location. So that's some of the specific research we're going into, and now we're also going into the universities. This year we put a CRADA together with the University of Maryland and the University of North Dakota. Those CRADAs are a lot for counter UAS, but they also do regular UAS operations. We're in the signature process now putting an MOA in place with FAA's Center of Excellence for UASs, which is ASSURE, that's run out of Mississippi State. And there are 22 universities around the United States that are part of this Center of Excellence. So when you go get research done, you go to the specialty of that university and they are able to help you. So you're not tied to one university when you do it. So we're trying to reach out, make sure we can answer the proper questions and get people involved. And the final thing that we're doing these last couple of years is we've got re-engaged with a government order board, which is a Sense and Avoid Science and Research Panel. And what it is, it has DOD, NASA, FAA, and DHS, and we get together and we talk about the hard problems. How can we help change policy, procedures, direction in the United States to be able to use UASs in the government? And it's been going on quite a few years. We, as you can see, the first topic was Sense and Avoid. That is the biggest issue we got to resolve. We are coming to understanding how to solve that problem, so we're also reaching out now to go past just Sense and Avoid to look at other issues that will affect the government use of UASs in the national airspace. And then finally, going forward, we do see this as a big problem, having gyrocopters landing at the White House and ultralights landing in the Capitol. It gets everybody excited. So there's been a big push to increase our capabilities and our understanding of the UAS systems. So what we're doing is first the RAPS RAMS program we talked about. Instead of having two different paths are going down, we're going to be combining them together. We're going to have both CBP and Coast Guard working together. We're also going to start concentrating on sensors over aircraft, because the sensors really are what's going to make or break us finding bad guys. An airplane is something to do something else with. We're trying to help with the logistics string and also the commonality between all the groups. We're looking at common data links and communication systems between Coast Guard and CBP. So when we do things, they can talk to each other. We can have a shorter logistics string because we all have common hardware, common software, and just makes things better all the way around. We're looking at standards for small UASs. Tactical, mail, and HALES all have well standards, designers defined on how to interface with them. Small UASs up at this point, it's each company comes up with their own standard, so you can't use the same controllers, you can't swap out sensors. We're talking to DARPA and other ones. All these are collaborative efforts to look at a way we can get small UASs to have a standard interface for comms, so you're able to control it with a common control system, also with the interfaces for payloads and other types of hardware that you can put on the aircraft. We're going to be investing in that. Jamming and spoofing, that's going to be an ongoing problem, because as we get smarter, the bad guys are going to get smarter, so we have to continue to come up with better ways to make sure that we can control what we're doing and watch what they're doing. Big issue now is sensors for the mail. MQ-9 mail is medium altitude long endurance aircraft. We're looking at combining how can we get better sensors for the MQ-9s and anything else that we happen to pull into the arsenal. Somebody is mentioning is how we've been standardizing on one platform. Maybe we need to look at other platforms and then come up with better sensors that can do a specific job that we're looking for. Fusion of data is another area we're looking at. That's a big part of collecting data. If I collect a lot of data and I can't fuse my ground, my air, everything else together in one place, it really becomes pretty useless. So we're going to be looking in the future is how we're going to combine it all together, how we're going to be able to talk across all components and come up with a better interdiction process. And finally, the other one is the traffic management. That's going to get worse and worse as time goes on. So we're going to continue working into is how do we improve traffic management of UASs with people, with other aircraft, with buildings, and anything else that may be out there that you could run into. And that's about what I got.
All right. Thanks, Tim. Jay.
All right, thank you, and thank you for inviting me to participate in this and share our perspective on UAVs, drones. I think that there's a big clash going on between two very powerful forces in American life, our security agencies and the great concern that Americans have over terrorism and terrorist attacks, and the business community, which wants freedom and innovation and space for innovation. And I think that in the drones area, we're going to see these two forces push against each other in some ways. We're basically, as a society, we're going to need to make some risk assessments here, risk and benefits. If guns were invented last year, we'd be having a panel here on the threats that guns pose and, you know, all the different ways that terrorists might use them and they might be used irresponsibly, and do we need to have regulations and so forth. There's a technology that was used both by the terrorists in Paris and in San Bernardino and is used in most bank robberies and is used irresponsibly by Americans, leading to tens of thousands of deaths. It's the automobile. What's the cost benefit there? So now we have this new technology, drones, that has the potential to be used for millions of things, and people are going to come up with lots of bright ideas for ways to use them, innovative ideas, ways that make our lives better. There's going to be a dark side. There's no question that there's a very real security risk from drones, UAVs. To a great extent, the ACLU doesn't have a dog in the fight about exactly what the right balance is for security versus innovation and freedom to let people fly drones however they see fit. Our biggest concern, with two exceptions, our biggest concern is that they not be used for mass surveillance. This is what I wrote our report about in 2011. Mass surveillance is our big concern. And mass surveillance use of drones is something that's both very far away but also very near. I talk to police and they say, you're so paranoid, we're using them basically for accident and crime scene reconstruction and for finding missing persons. They make tons of noise, they only stay up for 20 minutes, they're tiny. Why are you so worried about us watching entire cities and entire neighborhoods, 24/7? But, I think that the technology will move very quickly, the regulatory environment will move quickly, that will make it possible. Already we've seen companies selling that sort of persistent surveillance, wide area surveillance solutions based on manned aircraft and so forth. In terms of the Homeland Security applications that are out there, You can talk about both sort of the affirmative uses for to protect, but also the restrictive uses to protect against people who are using drones. I think that, you know, when it comes to emergencies, disasters, you know, hurricanes, we have no problem with those kinds of uses. We have no kinds of problem with limited uses in law enforcement. If there's a, you know, a warrant being served on a potentially dangerous mansion and law enforcement thinks that a drone would help the situation, we have no problem with that. Again, mass surveillance without suspicion is what we're worried about. Critical infrastructure is one of the uses. There was a law passed in New Jersey recently that banned the use of drones to photograph critical infrastructure, which was defined so broadly that it included like, you know, booths on the New Jersey Turnpike. You know, that's a problem, we think, because it's you know, the term critical infrastructure is not always very clearly defined, and can, you know, a nuclear power plant. We don't really have a problem necessarily with the restrictions of drones flying near nuclear power plants, but when it's construed so broadly, we do have a problem. And more broadly, I mean, the logic of using drones for anti-terrorism does suggest a certain mass surveillance, and we've seen this with the debates over NSA surveillance, which is, you know, collect everything about everybody just in case it becomes in use later. Why not fly over every city and photograph everybody and watch where every vehicle and every pedestrian goes at all times of day and night and just store that up for several years just in case there's a terrorist attack, and then we can press rewind on the lives of the terrorists and see where they went, see what they did, et cetera. But you can also press rewind on everybody else's life, which is a huge power to put in the hands of your government. And so a lot of Americans, the people we represent, don't think that that's the right balance. Similarly with drug war applications. The problem with the drug war from a privacy standpoint is that when you have a crime, you have a victim. You know, this person's been assaulted and they're mad. They go to the police, they complain. The drug war, and because drugs are a victimless crime, there is no victim who goes to the police and complains and says this crime was committed. So the police and the authorities have to actively search out violations, which means getting into people's lives. That's why the drug war has been at the heart of almost every like big California, you know, Supreme Court decision from Sorrello, which was on manned aircraft, to many others. So drug war, anti-terrorism, the logic of those things does suggest very wide surveillance because there's a need to want to store up everything just in case it's useful. And there's a logic that we're seeing, which is, you know, terrorists do X, they use X, therefore let's ban X. Terrorists use encryption, so we need to we need to put restrictions on encryption. Terrorists include, you know, use the refugee program, so we need to put restrictions on the refugee program. Terrorists do X, we need to restrict X. Well, what if X is freedom? Terrorists use freedom, they use our freedom. Let's restrict our freedom. That's the problem. And so we need to be very, very careful when we look at restrictions. And, you know, as I said, drones are a potential avenue of freedom, among other things, although we don't have any problem with regulating them. We're certainly not libertarians, not nearly as much as the industry is in many ways. Finally, let me just say that we are worried about the First Amendment as well. We are a photographers' rights organization, you know, that we would not want to see restrictions placed on drones for uses for photography, especially if the again, we don't have a problem with reasonable security measures, and we think that anywhere that drones are deemed safe to fly, people should have a right to take photographs with them. The thing that we're worried about happening, we've already seen this to some extent, is security rationales being used as an excuse to stop people from taking photographs, for example, of their own government. For example, we've seen drones used overseas where the regulations aren't as strict by protesters to photograph police as police riot and attack peaceful demonstrations. We don't want the government watching the people, but we do think that people should have the tools to watch their government. I'm running out of time here. I promised to try and stay around 5 minutes. But those are some initial thoughts, and I look forward to a good conversation.
Thank you, Jay. I'm going to jump straight to my third theme of the themes that I was hoping to focus on with our discussion in the interest of time and to get to some audience questions, which is, and the theme is really about the pace of change, the pace of what's happening, really referenced by everyone who's spoken so far. So I think it's kind of the central, one of the central questions here about whether the way that, and of course the report is focused on, if you will, a governmental viewpoint, uses of UAS in the Homeland Security enterprise, which is bigger than DHS, but nonetheless this is a governmental perspective. And the pace of change is incredible, referenced, as I mentioned, by everyone so far. Jay, your comments about, you know, the potential for mass surveillance as I was driving in here, which is always an extended exercise, as anyone who lives in the city knows. There was a piece about companies using cell phones and getting access to the location data of people attending political events so that they can then send them texts saying, you know, sign up for my product, which is a, you know, a political pitch in essence. And it's sort of interesting, right? This is almost all of us have cell phones, and so now there's in the private sector a mechanism where people can establish your political leanings, your associations, and it's non-voluntary. It's something that is provided by the cell service. Similarly, you know, there's been a lot of discussion about UAS as being used to provide internet service, which is also great, but which creates the same capability, right? A network that knows where across an incredible broad range of terrain people are located and some of what they're doing there. As a private sector capability, and of course the government could certainly theoretically do the same thing, although as we've heard in the Homeland Security arena, that's not something that's currently happening. So, you know, what is the hope, or what is the possibility, or maybe more specifically, what do we need to do for the government's approach to these issues to kind of keep up with the pace of that change?
Over to you, Admiral. Piece of cake. I have tried to think about this notion of the pace, the pace of change over time. I mean, change is the dynamic in all of our lives. You know, from the very basic, I don't want a blue toothbrush because I've always been using a red toothbrush and it's worked. A kind of fundamental reality to the dramatically complex at the other end of the day, which is what we're sort of thinking of here with UAS. But I'm equally concerned in my darker moments about sort of the acceleration of the pace of change. In other words, even if you think of it in terms of historical precedents, we had what is documented to have been a 1,000-year Roman Empire, okay? And we have sort of a documented reality of a 400 to 500 year British Empire sort of dominating things around the world. And now we're 200 years into this experiment called America. Maybe the last 100 or so puts it as a dominant player on the stage. And we've all heard references to the Age of America and all that kind of thing. And well, in this acceleration of the pace of change from Rome to London to Washington, D.C., are we about at the end, you know, of our impact time, so to speak, as a player in the world? So you have that bigger picture notion of the acceleration of the pace of change. And within that, your question is a question that really deserves attention, because it's a matter of how it's not linear. It may even be asymptotic. And that's even scarier to sort of to ponder and think about. And I'm not trying to give everybody, you know, nightmares to this is the Christmas season full of joy, et cetera, et cetera. But the reality here is these things are happening to us, with us, as the calendar keeps ticking by. So absolutely, I would hope that the guys in the department, both from the policy perspective as well as the hardcore R&D, S&T work that Tim and his guys are working on in the S&T branch, get anchored somehow so that the answer to your question becomes something manageable and doable within this Homeland Security enterprise for the well-being of our country overall. I believe this secretary, Jay, Secretary Johnson, has really brought some discipline back into the department in that regard with reconstituting the Joint Requirements Council, the capture of almost what was the original intent of the Homeland Security Act in 2002, which was dream up your notion of what is required to get done, and then take the steps both in terms of research and budget reality to capture the prioritized version of that joint requirements set and get on with the business of quote unquote solving the problem. But that, in that same vein, going to the ACLU side of this, I could not endorse more strongly that for the ultimate well-being of our moral foundation as a nation, I keep going back to Franklin's classic old quote about, you know, those who would give up even a moment of, he used the word safety, but if we substitute security, he who would give up even a moment of safety for a lifetime of security deserve neither, you know, because it's the notion of how we grapple with those very issues that reinforce our constitutional fundamentals as a nation that are at stake here when we sort of tinker on the edge with a lot of technological capability and how we're going to govern those things over time. In a more mature Department of Homeland Security with a stronger policy shop thinking about these things and keeping those cards face up on the table, and then the instruments of making it happen, both in a management sense and in a research sense, those are questions that actually that absolutely deserve attention.
My point on it. Yeah, I agree that we're moving extremely fast in this, but I sit on several boards and belong to several committees, and what is great about what's going on here is that we, the government, are joining up with the Googles, the Facebook, all the other ones out there in the commercial sector that have actually, in their mind, a bigger need for us to move forward on this and come up with policies and procedures to do this, that we are going to come up with a better solution out of it. The nice part is that they have millions that they're putting into this operation. So we listen to them, what their needs are, helping them develop, you know, their processes, and then we're going to take those back, and we're going to have, hopefully, with the FAA and NASA, listening to them, because the FAA and NASA are ones that holding these conferences that are bringing in all the private sector, or the and finding out what they need in terms of their needs, and then we look at what our needs are, how this deconflicts, with how we can deconflict all the problems with that and come up with a final solution. So even though we're moving very fast, we have a huge force that's working together on this. We're not fighting with the public like we have done in other areas. We're actually finding out what is the best solution for all of us. So in the long run, I think we're going to have a very good, within the next 1-2 years, a way of handling all these problems, and it's going to be a joint effort and a joint solution.
Yeah, I'd just like to piggyback on that just for a second. This, the notion that we used to wonder about, you know, the whole idea of a public-private partnership, this is one of these areas which demands a public-private partnership for the well-being of the nation at the other end of the day. So I could not endorse more strongly Tim's point with regard to reaching to where the leading edge of the technological advances are occurring and finding their opportunity to make well what our government challenges are to serve the nation.
So from our perspective, looking at drones as a surveillance technology, first of all, it's always the case that technology is moving at the speed of light, and the society, its regulatory apparatuses, the jurisprudence, and just people's ability to digest the new reality are always much slower. With drones, actually, in somewhat for us is an exception. We look at another surveillance technology like ALPR, license plate scanners, which are being used to capture license plates of cars as they move around by police departments. Some are just, you know, putting them up everywhere and saving the data of everybody. We don't actually object to them being used for looking for cars that are wanted, but we do object to everybody's license data being saved so that they can put in my license, see that I was at this corner at 2 a.m. last month, et cetera, et cetera. But there we had no discussion whatsoever. police departments just sort of engaged in what I call policy making by procurement. They just went out and bought the technology and started using it. They didn't ask permission from their communities. They often got grants from DHS, thereby short-circuiting the local democratic process, which they would normally have in terms of, you know, going before the city council, and just started putting it in place. That did not happen with drones, because the FAA has been holding everything back because of their concerns about safety. We don't have a dog in the fight about whether the FAA has been going too slow or too fast. It's not our, you know, we're not security experts, but you know, we're not aviation safety experts. But so number one, this drones UASs has been an exception. Number two, it's different also in that there are two sides. There's government wanting to use drones, and there's the private sector wanting to use drones. And so the rapid innovation in the use of UAVs by the private sector is going to pose security challenges that, you know, that other technologies don't. One point on the public-private partnerships, I'm sure that there's lots of great potential for lots of great things to happen on public-private partnerships, but there's also potential from our point of view for it to be a nightmare. If we're talking like Google putting in place live Street View or live Google Earth, so they're not just taking a snapshot of my backyard once or twice a year, but now we're having live video of my backyard, including when my daughter is out there safe sunbathing, et cetera, and then you could, you know, then they pair up with DHS. You know, now I'm starting to feel really uncomfortable. So just a point there.
Well, I think your comfort level is proper, frankly, but the notion of partnership would suggest that the stakes, we're trying to get cards turned face up on the table so that decision makers can see all of the implications, including the public or the privacy issues that are absolutely an imperative to have on the table. We want those cards to be face up so we can make good decisions with regard to them as well.
Yeah, and one thing that is good about DHS is that you do have a privacy, you know, you have privacy concerns are institutionalized and represented in an institutional way.
I hired the first one.
Yeah.
So I understand that to be the case.
Unlike many other agencies. But, you know, there is what I wrote a paper.
At TSA, by the way.
Right.
And then we stole her from TSA and put her over the department. So.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, but there's also the concern in terms of public-private partnership. I should have added that that private companies will push government to engage in surveillance because they're selling surveillance technologies, and the government will do more surveillance than they otherwise would for that reason. That's a pattern we have seen in the past.
Just to make the one point that actually we were struck in our research by how slow the adoption was and how conservative, particularly law enforcement, was, because not only is there the FAA, but there is a huge stigma attached to drones in the country. Their negatives are worse than many political candidates who will go unnamed. There's a natural break there where if there is a desire for broader use of these systems, I think most law enforcement, I would say most, when we talk to National Association of Chiefs of Police and others, are very acutely aware of this issue, and they have actually made, in many cases, decisions that it's just not worth it. There are other policing technologies that are more readily applicable, perhaps more controversial in some cases. Cell phones, body cams, these are the things that are eating their day, and they don't need another issue on the plate. So that was an interesting finding, and I think underscores how, as DHS and others begin to use these technologies more broadly, the public dialogue on the issue is very important, lest there be a backlash that you know, makes the technology obsolete by sort of failure to have effectively communicated what you're actually doing with it to the public.
Yeah, that's a point that definitely struck me in reading the report. On the defense side, you know, the demand for UAV capability is almost infinite. It's in any case well in excess of anything we have any hope of providing, but here the demand is actually quite limited in by comparison. Let me go to audience questions. I know there's not much time left, but I want to make sure we get in some audience questions. And here on the aisle, you're going to have a microphone brought to you. So,
thank you. My name is Ray Young. I represent one of the six UAS test sites that the Congress set up in the FAA Modernization and Reform Act of 2012. I represent New York. I was up there in Rome, New York yesterday. Actually, if I was not here today, I would be witnessing a historic event that's going to take place in Syracuse this afternoon, which is the first MQ-9 operation to take place at a Class C international airport, at Syracuse International Airport. I notice you have a picture in the report of a New York Air National Guard MQ-9 sitting in front of their hangar at Syracuse. 2 years ago, the FAA would not even have considered allowing a large UAS to operate at a international airport. So things are changing fast. I would characterize, and I'll throw this open for comment from the panel, Mr. Brenner's comment about the slow pace of change, I would characterize it as a logjam. When the logjam breaks, things are going to move very, very quickly. We're already seeing that. The FAA, we're at FAA-designated test sites, so we work very closely with the FAA. We're involved in NASA. We have a contract with NASA to support UAS traffic management. Delighted that DHS is putting money behind that, because NASA doesn't have much money. They have a lot of good ideas. But things are happening very fast. The Section 333 exemptions for commercial operators are about at least 3,000 that have been issued to people to operate small UAS. Very liberal. What happened this past week with the announcement by the Secretary of Transportation and the FAA Administrator on the registration of small drones, it is, I think, very significant, because the Secretary of Transportation has told everybody who registers a drone that they are now aviators. They're operating in the national airspace system. So it's not just Google and Amazon who are committing billions. The pace of change is rapidly going to accelerate. Comment made about this report.
Let me give the panel a chance to respond, because we're right at the end of our time.
Please do.
Sam, if you could just maybe just, I know one of the key things in the report was about experimentation, and he mentioned the test sites. So if you could touch that, and then I'll let the rest of the panel also respond.
Sir, I would strongly agree with your assessment that we could be headed for exponential growth at a certain point in time. My comment was just related to law enforcement use, but I think on the commercial and personal use side, we see the sort of exponential growth curve, and with FAA approval, when the governors are removed, so to speak, I agree that this is a situation where you could see overnight a transformation, and including particularly from commercial sector interests. What Amazon alone has said that they intend to do is one thing, but I agree with you that there are many, many other users that are out there. The test sites have been absolutely essential to moving things forward, as has been the SAA, the sense and avoid technology. So we are a few technologies and a few flight safety issues and a few experimentation programs away from seeing some serious growth. And I'll just use on the land example. Last year when we wrote this report, self-driving cars were 5 to 10 years away. This year we have self-driving cars with a Tesla update, and all of the German automakers are all over it. And so, you know, it was Google, then it was Tesla, now it's everybody else. So this is why this is a technology that should be watched extremely closely, and why, from a regulatory perspective, you have to be prepared, as I think the FAA is attempting to be.
I'll just say, I think the logjam is a good word. I would also maybe use the language pent-up demand, I think that there's already pent-up demand, and I think demand will only increase as people see what new things can be done with the technology.
I couldn't agree more. This logjam is a good word, because it's like a step function that's going to occur. You know, when we plot our way along until the regulation is issued, and then there will be a step function explosion. Business Week suggests $8 billion annually by 2018, which is literally right around the corner. So your thought pattern, I think, is absolutely right on target.
I'll try and fit in one additional question here in the front.
Hi, Samira Daniels, Ramsey Decisions. Glad to see you, Admiral Loy. This is directed to you, because I think since you have a historic, relationship with Homeland Security, The question I have is this, that given this acceleration that you've, you know, pointed to, the potential for it, in reviewing, I had the good fortune of reviewing some of the reports on privacy that were conducted by the Senate, and I wanted to know, given this acceleration and given you know, some of the mishaps of on privacy that have occurred, whether you feel the people who assess risk have good enough logic and the logical ability and critical thinkability, because in reviewing those reports, you know, there were so many kinds of errors that would, you know, grammar school, exactly. So I was just wondering how that's being.
Well, I've lost, you know, on a personal touch, I've lost where the department has come, so to speak, with that intellectual capability, so to speak. You know, I guess if we take a read from our participants in the debate last night, we have even more worries with regard to that question. But the notion was, as a seed planted, as Jay might recall and endorsed just a moment ago, the notion of having that card always turning face up on the table in the course of decision making processes to be institutionalized at the department over time. That was our intention when we stood up the department. You know, when we made those initial hires, and as you can see, both in private corporations and in government elsewhere, the notion of a privacy officer and hopefully an adequate staff with regard to being able to answer your question correctly has, I believe, found its way to permanence to a degree in places where we should have had them for a long time, didn't, but now do. So the maturing process of having that as a positive influence on the decision-making apparatus at the department, I think, is hopefully there. And I have a good friend who was the old chief of staff of the Army who said, hope is not a method, and I get that. So we have to consciously be improving that capability over time. And it belongs in the general counsel's world, and it belongs in the policy world as well. As direct counselors to the deputy and to the secretary, so it's not filtered all the way through however many filters that are not going to allow the real reality to get there. The boss has to be able to have the benefit of that counsel.
Okay. Well, thank you all for coming. It's been a great event, great discussion. I see that those who are here live have the report, many of you in your hands. It's also going to be available on the web, particularly for those tuning in on the web. It'll be available on our website. And please join me in thanking our panel for a great discussion.